Yes.
So good evening, and thanks everyone for coming. For people that don't know me, I'm Dr. JoAnna Wawrzycki. I'm one of the obstetrician gynecologists at Rutland Women's Healthcare. And I'm going to be talking tonight about the causes and treatments of abnormal uterine bleeding. One of the reasons that I wanted to give this talk is because I see this every day and I know how much of a problem it is for many women. And when people come in and I'm explaining the different causes of bleeding and the different treatments available, it can be very overwhelming to hear this stuff for the first time. So this will be a nice introduction. We are going to cover a lot of material, but at least if you are suffering from abnormal bleeding or caring for someone that's suffering for this, you'll start to get a better understanding of why that might be and what we can do about it. So this is just an outline of what we're going to be going through tonight. We're going to start out just talking about what's normal and what's not normal in terms of uterine bleeding. We're going to talk about the causes of abnormal uterine bleeding. We're going to talk about what's involved in diagnosing the problem and also what treatments are available. So before we talk about what's abnormal, just to kind of lay some ground rules about what is normal, a normal menstrual cycle is between 21 and 35 days. However, it can vary from month to month, so a lot of women will report that their cycles vary by a few days, and that's very normal. Most people will also describe that the first day or two is heavy, though usually when they say heavy, they're not changing their pad more than every 3 or 4 hours. In general, they're not reporting any big clots or gushes of blood. So now we're going to start talking about what's abnormal. So some people come in because of heavy bleeding. So heavy bleeding can occur at the regular monthly intervals. However, the cycle can last too long, so sometimes women will have a period that lasts more than 9 days, or the amount of bleeding can be too heavy. So people will describe passing clots or big gushes of blood, or they're changing their pad or their tampon every hour or two. And if this goes on or if it's severe, people can become anemic from it. And those women will often describe feeling lightheaded or just run down and tired, and they even begin to feel some palpitations. So another type of irregular bleeding, another type of abnormal bleeding is irregular bleeding. And when I'm talking about irregular bleeding, what I mean is that it's unpredictable. So this is when bleeding can occur at completely unpredictable times. Either women just can never tell when they're going to get their period, their cycles always vary by a week or more, or some women may go weeks or even months without a period. This can also refer to when you get spotting or bleeding in between your periods. When people have this type of bleeding, it can give us clues as to what's going on even right off the bat. For example, cycles that vary by more than 10 days often suggest that someone is not ovulating or not releasing an egg every month, and so that can be a clue there. So to start off talking about what causes abnormal bleeding, we're going to start off talking about some structural problems that can cause abnormal bleeding. And when I say structural, what I mean is things that happen in the uterus themselves as opposed to, say, hormonal alterations. We're also going to be talking about hormonal disturbances that can affect bleeding, bleeding disorders, and certain medications. We're not going to spend time talking about pregnancy, but just a reminder that anyone that hasn't gone through menopause, people do have bleeding in pregnancy. So if you're bleeding pattern suddenly changes, that's always important to rule out. So when we're talking about structural abnormalities within the uterus, there are several different things that can happen, and we're going to go through each of these individually. So before we talk about what's abnormal, we're going to go through some of the normal anatomy of the uterus. So this is the uterus itself there. Okay, that's where women carry a pregnancy. And this is the endometrial lining here. And that's what you shed every month when you get your period. And so this little portion down here is called the cervix. And even though this is attached to the uterus, it's often discussed separately from the uterus itself, and the reason for that is because it's made up of a different kind of tissue. And so, this is where we do pap smears, and there are HPV-related changes that happen to the cervix and not the uterus. So we'll often talk about these two things separately, even though they're attached to each other. And then this is the fallopian tube and the ovaries. So fibroids are probably the most common structural abnormalities that occur in the uterus. They're very common. Up to 20% of women have fibroids, and in African American women that number is even higher. These can occur in different places on the uterus, so they can occur on the inside lining, they can occur on the outside, but when there are a lot of fibroids, or if there's one large fibroid, it can cause the uterus to be quite enlarged, and it can also cause bleeding to be irregular and quite heavy. So this is just to show you what some of these fibroids look like, and just to point out that they can occur, like I was saying, in different places on the uterus, and this is going to have an impact on how we treat them. So again, this is the endometrial lining here, and so sometimes you can have a fibroid that protrudes into the cavity itself. Sometimes the fibroids are sort of embedded in the muscle of the uterus here, and sometimes they're kind of sticking out of the surface on the top of the uterus. And this, like I was saying, can affect how we can treat them. So if we want to surgically remove a fibroid, we can sometimes go in vaginally and remove a fibroid that might be right here in the cavity. But if the fibroids are here or here, then that would require an abdominal surgery, either an open incision or a laparoscopy.
Do those show up on ultrasound?
They do, but it can be, sometimes it can be difficult because, you know, this cavity that's, the question was, would these fibroids show up on ultrasound? And they will show up on ultrasound, but we'll see some ultrasounds in a minute, but what happens is that this cavity is, not as easily visualized, so everything looks kind of pressed together, so it can sometimes be difficult to tell exactly where it's coming from, if it's in the muscle or if it's completely protruding out into the cavity. So polyps are another type of benign growth, meaning a non-cancerous growth that occurs inside the uterus. These can also cause heavy bleeding, and often women will describe bleeding in between their periods or bleeding with intercourse. Unlike other types of polyps, polyps in the uterus don't progress to cancer. However, they can appear very similar on imaging. So when we find these, we do tend to take them out to make sure that we're not missing a cancer. And so this is showing you what a polyp looks like. And unlike the fibroids, which were scattered all over, these really just occur inside the uterus. And they're just very soft and fleshy, but they can cause quite a bit of bleeding. So this is another type of structural abnormality of the uterus. It's called adenomyosis, and this is a certain condition where this lining of the uterus here, so this is a normal uterus, this lining makes its way inside the muscle of the uterus. And when that happens, what happens is that the uterus becomes very boggy, and it doesn't like to contract down, and so it can bleed a lot. This happens a lot more often after women have had children, and there is a thought that cesarean section increases the risk of this. It's very difficult to treat medically. So women who are put on birth control pills who don't respond for whatever reason, you know, your flag might go up that this might be what's going on. And sometimes on ultrasound, they will describe the uterus as being, globular in appearance, and they can suggest that as well. So we're going to start shifting from some of the more benign lesions that, even though they're non-cancerous, can certainly cause trouble, to some of the more concerning lesions because they can progress to something more concerning, like a malignancy. So endometrial hyperplasia is a condition where that uterine lining overgrows, and it is considered a precancerous lesion. So when we find this, usually on a biopsy, the pathologist actually puts it into categories for us. So some types of hyperplasia, called simple hyperplasia, have a pretty low risk of progressing to cancer. However, if the pathologist tells us that they found hyperplasia with atypia, that's got a pretty high risk of cancer. And so those women are usually recommended to have a hysterectomy. There are some exceptions if women really want to have a baby and haven't done that yet. But when women do have a hysterectomy, they actually find that up to 30% of those women already have cancer. So it was hiding in there, we just hadn't found it yet. So that one has a pretty high risk of progression. So cervical cancer can also cause bleeding. So you know, luckily we have screening tests for cervical cancer, and so it's pretty uncommon these days that people present with an actual cervical cancer. We usually find these abnormal cells and treat them before it progresses to cancer, but occasionally people do present with a cervical cancer. And so if you go into your doctor and you have an exam done, this is, when we're doing a pap smear, this is what we see. We see this nice healthy cervix. If you were ever to go in for an evaluation for bleeding and they saw a lesion there, you know, you should expect that they're going to do a biopsy, because a pap smear is not really going to be adequate to make a diagnosis of cancer from something like this. The kind of classic presentation of cervical cancer is people that have bleeding with intercourse. However, there are a lot of other reasons people have bleeding with intercourse, and it's not usually cancer. That's the presentation. So uterine cancer, and remember we were talking about the cervix being sort of separate from the uterine cancer, from the uterus. Uterine cancer is the main thing that, you know, us as obstetrician gynecologists are trying to rule out when someone comes in with these heavy irregular periods, because this is the one of the most common types of uterine cancer is endometrial cancer, and that's that cancer of the uterine lining. We do know some risk factors for endometrial cancer. For example, obesity is a big risk factor. Women who get their periods at an early age, and also women that have had no pregnancies. And the reason, the thing that ties these things together is that it's a pattern of being exposed to estrogen for a long period of time. So women who are starting off their periods really young or going through menopause really late, those are going to be risk factors for endometrial cancer. Also, when we talked a little bit about those women that go weeks or months between their periods, that's going to be a risk factor too, because that lining's building up and can get overgrown and put you at risk for cancer if you're doing that for years and years. So this is just to remind you, when we're talking about the endometrium and endometrial cancer, we're talking about this lining right here, and this is showing a little cancer developing there. So another type of uterine cancer is a sarcoma. That is a pretty rare form of cancer, and the only reason I'm mentioning it is because these look a lot like fibroids on imaging, and so while it's rare, we always kind of have that in the back of our mind. So if we're seeing an ultrasound and it has a fibroid, and then all of a sudden we're seeing that that fibroid is growing very rapidly, this is something that you'd want to exclude. And this is showing here what a normal fibroid would look like, and this is a sarcoma, and you can see it's just developing extra blood supply and starting to creep into the surrounding tissue. But that can be different to tell apart on imaging. All right, so we were just talking about the structural causes of abnormal bleeding, and now we're going to start talking about some of the hormonal things that can cause bleeding to be irregular. We're not going to spend a lot of time on physiology, but this is just a reminder of how the brain and the pelvic organs communicate with each other. And this is, you know, something that comes into play a lot when we're seeing people who are missing their period or going long months between periods. The brain has an organ inside called the pituitary gland, and that is a hormone-producing organ. And that organ will send messages to the ovary to release an egg. Pituitary also releases other hormones. It releases a hormone called prolactin, and prolactin is what helps you produce milk when you're breastfeeding. And these things feed back to each other, so that's why when women are breastfeeding, they actually don't get their period a lot of the time. However, the thing about prolactin is that certain other things can cause prolactin to be elevated, like certain kinds of medications, certain kinds of brain tumors, and actually even hypothyroidism. So if any of those things are going on and your prolactin level is high, that can also stop you from ovulating. So all those things are related. There are also hormones produced from the pituitary that are stress hormones. And so when people are going through stress or medical illness, that all comes into play too, and that can suppress ovulation. So as I mentioned briefly, the thyroid is sometimes a big culprit in changing people's menstrual cycles. So when we look at the thyroid, we either can have an underactive thyroid, which is called hypothyroidism, or an overactive thyroid, which is called hyperthyroidism. Hypothyroidism is what we see more often, and that's women come in and they complain of being tired all the time, maybe a little weight gain, some dry skin, they usually feel cold all the time. A lot of times when women come in and they're just starting to notice a difference in their menstrual cycles, this is a test that I almost always order because thyroid abnormalities are so common. Another very common hormonal disorder is called polycystic ovarian syndrome. Is something that we suspect most often when women present, you know, in their 20s or 30s, and they say, my periods have always been irregular. And these women will often go weeks or even months between their periods, sometimes even years. It's a condition where the body produces too much androgens, and the result of that is an imbalance. And the effect that that has on the ovaries is that while the ovary produces a lot of little follicles, none of those follicles mature to the point of releasing an egg. And so those women don't ovulate, but when we look at their ovaries on ultrasound, we can often see all those little follicles that are developing. If someone is diagnosed with polycystic ovarian syndrome, it's important to also think about screening them for diabetes because these women are at risk for glucose impairment as well. So in order to have polycystic ovarian syndrome, you do have to meet some specific criteria. I mentioned one of them, which is a polycystic appearance of the ovaries on ultrasound. And that's how, you know, this condition was first identified. However, you don't have to have this because you only have to have two of the three. So the other two criteria are irregular menses. And the third would be either laboratory or clinical evidence of elevated androgens. So for example, something clinically would be if a woman comes in and they have a lot of facial hair or hair on their back or chest or other places that are undesirable, or if they have a lot of acne. But as you can imagine, you know, especially in certain cultures or in teenagers, these things can be pretty common, and it's not always polycystic ovarian syndrome. So in talking about irregular menses, we put into a sort of a separate category people who all of a sudden stop getting their period. And we define this as amenorrhea when people go at least 3 months without their period. So some of these people will have polycystic ovarian syndrome because, like we mentioned, people in that situation can go months without a period. However, if someone had normal periods and then all of a sudden they stopped, we do want to look at other things going on. And a lot of the time this is going to be going back to that interplay of how the brain and the ovaries are communicating. So want to rule out things like stress or recent medical illness, or look to see if they've all of a sudden lost a lot of weight, or maybe they suffer from anorexia, or have some sort of risk factor for having an elevation of their prolactin levels. On the flip side, sometimes it's not the brain, and the brain is sending out all the right signals, but the ovaries have actually stopped functioning. And so it can be either one of those two situations, and we can usually tell them apart by doing some pretty basic laboratory tests. So bleeding disorders are an often overlooked cause of abnormal uterine bleeding. We think of them more often in teenagers who, from when they first present, have these massively heavy periods. But when they've actually done studies looking at women even in their 30s or 40s who present with heavy periods, they found that about 1 in 5 of those women have an underlying bleeding disorder. The most common is called von Willebrand's disease, and again, we can pick this up on lab testing. One way we get clued into a possible bleeding problem is if women have other bleeding symptoms, if they're prone to nosebleeds or gum bleeds, or if they say that everyone in their family has always had heavy periods or, you know, needed transfusions and that sort of thing. So it is also important to look at medications because people take a lot of medications, and a lot of these medications can affect bleeding. Birth control pills we often give to help control abnormal bleeding. However, sometimes if people are skipping pills or taking them late, or sometimes a pill just doesn't agree with a particular individual and they can actually cause irregular bleeding. Anticoagulants, so this is, you know, people who have a history of blood clots and maybe they're on an anticoagulant that they've been on for a while. However, if something, some other medical illness came up, that can actually affect the levels of anticoagulant in their body, and so that could be a way that your bleeding gets increased. As we talked about before, some of these mood stabilizers, some psychiatric drugs can cause elevations in prolactin, and so that can affect your bleeding patterns. Women who are undergoing chemotherapy unfortunately often have trouble with heavy bleeding. And also people who are on certain herbs. So, I mean, I think that a lot of women may not identify what herbs they're on when they go in to see their providers because they don't think that they have any sort of medical significance on this element of healthcare. However, I have this up here just to kind of remind you, this is kind of how they developed Coumadin, which was one of our biggest blood thinners. And they discovered this incidentally when some cows ingested it and had bleeding problems. So some of these herbs can be pretty potent. And the ones that are the biggest culprits are listed here, ginseng, ginkgo, and motherwort. But there certainly are others. So if you did recently start taking an herb or your patient started taking an herb, that would be something to think about, that maybe that could be related. So when someone comes in with abnormal bleeding and we're trying to figure out the cause, there are certain steps that we take in order to accomplish that. And usually it does involve some laboratory tests. One of the first things we'll do is to check to make sure that you're not becoming anemic, because people who are having a lot of blood loss sometimes can become anemic, sometimes to the point of needing a transfusion. Thyroid abnormalities, again, are a big culprit, and so we often check for that. And if there are other symptoms or things that we picked up, we might also screen for some of these other hormonal disorders that we talked about. We'll often get some imaging just to assess for any of those structural abnormalities. And the gold standard for imaging is really a vaginal ultrasound. It's a nice option because it doesn't give you any radiation. It also can, by using the vaginal probe, you get up very close to the pelvic organs, and so you are able to get some good pictures of the lining of the uterus and the ovaries. Occasionally, if we see a concerning lesion, we may decide to proceed to an MRI or a procedure called a hysteroscopy, which I'll talk about in more detail in a little bit. So this is an ultrasound. And so this is the outline. This is kind of looking at the uterus from the side, okay? This is a normal uterus, and this is the outline of the uterus here. And this is a normal uterine lining, so it's nice and thin. This uterus here is showing you, so this is the uterus itself, this is the outline. It's showing you some large fibroids. And so that's kind of what I was saying. See how this is the cavity, but it's all sort of smooshed down, so you can't really see, you know, in this picture, is this really all in the muscle wall, or does this protrude into the cavity and it's just pressing out this way? It's a little bit hard to say. There is another type of ultrasound where we can actually inject saline into here so that it'll fill this space and it'll make it a little easier for us to see where that lesion is. In order to exclude the possibility of a cancer or a precancerous lesion, we will often decide to do a biopsy. And whether or not we do a biopsy will depend on a couple of different things. It'll depend on the patient's age, how severe the bleeding is, if they have a family history of cancer. All those things will help us decide whether we should be doing a biopsy. Biopsies can often be done right in the office, which is nice because you avoid a trip to the operating room. And this is kind of showing you how it's done. So this is when you get a regular pelvic exam. This is kind of what's going on, looking at it from the side. This is the speculum here. And then there's a little straw-like instrument called a pipel that's inserted, and that goes in through the vagina and actually passes through the cervix and is able to sample the uterine lining. People can get sometimes pretty crampy during this, but otherwise, you know, do quite well after it. kind of one of the pitfalls of this is that, as you can see, you know, we're looking at the cervix here, but once this pipel passes the cervix, it's really sampling this lining blindly. We can't see what we're biopsying. So we're moving this straw in every different direction to try to make sure we get all the different walls of the uterus. However, there is a potential that if there's a small lesion there, you might not get it. So if the biopsy is negative, but someone's having some irregular bleeding, and especially if there's something on ultrasound that's concerning, then you probably can't stop there. So that's when we'll often proceed to one of these other more thorough diagnostic procedures. The first one is a DNC, and the second one is a hysteroscopy, and we'll talk about those next. So a dilation and curettage, or a DNC, is typically done in the operating room, and that's due to the fact that when we're doing a DNC, we need to pass this instrument called a curette in through the cervix, and it's a little bit wider than the cervix would normally allow. So we use little instruments to increase this dilation here, and then we pass this curette in and just do a scraping of this entire lining of the uterus. This is temporary. So when we do this, this is just the lining of the uterus that you would normally shed every month. So once we scrape this, the next month you're going to build that lining back up. It's not a permanent procedure. Hysteroscopy is done by passing a camera through the cervix, and it allows you to visualize the inside of the uterine cavity. So this is showing you what a normal uterine cavity looks like, and you can actually, these little holes here are actually the fallopian tubes. That's where they're entering the uterus. Here you see a nice big polyp that's coming into play. And so what's nice about hysteroscopy is that when you see something like this, you can go in and remove it. So this can either be done with a little bit of an electrical instrument, or people can just actually grab this and twist it off, and then you can look at with a camera afterward and make sure you've gotten the whole thing. Often after you do a hysteroscopy, you'll do a DNC just to make sure that you're not missing any little hidden microscopic lesions. So in terms of how we treat some of these lesions that we find, it really depends on the location and the size of the lesions. So if we see a lot of small little fibroids, we don't always have to go and take them out, because we do know fibroids are benign. And the main reason usually that people are coming in, complaining of fibroids is because of bleeding. So if they're having a lot of small little fibroids, we might talk about birth control pills or a Mirena IUD, or if they appear to be in the cavitary, in the uterine cavity, we can maybe remove them hysteroscopically. However, occasionally these fibroids are very large, and they cause the whole uterus to be enlarged, and so those often require a surgery or other procedures to shrink them if people are having abdominal distension or heavy bleeding from a large lesion. For women who are suffering from abnormal bleeding because of hormonal dysfunction, if you can correct the underlying problem, like if someone is having a hypothyroidism, correcting their thyroid disorder is going to help you correct their bleeding, hopefully. But other times you're not able to correct the underlying problem, like if someone's undergoing chemotherapy. And then those women also might be good candidates for some of the procedures that I mentioned. And we're going to go through some of these procedures in more detail. So hormonal therapy is often the first line treatment that we'll offer patients. It's very low intervention. Birth control pills, are often given, even to teenagers, because they do help regulate the period. They tend to make your periods lighter, come at more predictable intervals. And there are variants of oral contraceptives that work pretty similarly for people that can't remember to take a pill, such as the NuvaRing or the patch. And so those are kind of the first line options. The Mirena IUD is actually a really great option for abnormal bleeding. We're going to talk about that a little bit more in a little more detail, but that's actually FDA approved for abnormal uterine bleeding. Progesterone therapy is also a very important therapeutic regimen that we employ for different reasons. So a lot of times we use a mini pill for birth control. It doesn't have any estrogen in it, so women who can't take estrogen because of a history of clots or other family history can take the mini pill. However, Progesterone is also used for those women who don't get their periods for over 3 months. So if that's the case, we can give progesterone in intervals to help bring on a period. So women who don't want to take a pill every day, sometimes one option would be to say, okay, well, if you go longer than 2 or 3 months, then we need to give you some progesterone to help you get your period so that you don't build that lining up too much. And so that is a nice option too. Also, sometimes when women come into the emergency room because they're having very heavy bleeding, we can use higher doses of progesterone to actually stop their bleeding. Another medical therapy that we can use is something called Lupron. Lupron puts women into what we call a medical menopause, meaning it just shuts down hormone production. This wouldn't be considered a long-term strategy, but it can be really effective for a short-term goal, such as getting through chemotherapy or getting a patient through to the point where a planned surgery is. And so that is just something that you might hear about. So as I mentioned, the Mirena IUD is FDA approved to treat abnormal bleeding. Actually, it's also used to treat endometrial hyperplasia. So for women who had this precancerous lesion, who maybe haven't had children yet and who don't want to lose their uterus, an IUD can be, the Mirena IUD, because it has the progesterone in it, can sometimes be used to treat hyperplasia. The IUD does not have any estrogen in it, and the amount of progesterone that's in it is actually pretty small. So most women don't experience any hormonal side effects from the Mirena. They should, however, expect that for the first 3 to 6 months, they're going to have some irregular bleeding. And the way that the Mirena IUD works is different from birth control. So this is the T-shaped IUD inside the uterus here. And how it works to prevent pregnancy is by changing the consistency of this mucus inside here so that sperm and egg actually can't meet. And the second way that it works is by keeping this lining so thin that a pregnancy doesn't want to implant there. And the second way that I mentioned, that keeping the lining so thin, is how it helps with bleeding, because it's keeping that lining very, very thin. In the process of doing that, when people are first having this IUD placed, people might have some of that irregular bleeding as this lining is thinning out. So we mentioned how hysteroscopy can be used to remove lesions already, but this is just kind of showing you, again, that these are the types of lesions that we'd be removing by hysteroscopy, the ones that are right inside here. And this is showing a fibroid that's being removed hysteroscopically. So I'm going to talk a little bit about something called endometrial ablation, which is a nice minimally invasive procedure that can be used to treat abnormal bleeding. I mentioned before that a D&C, when we do that scraping, is temporary. It just removes that lining and then it grows back the next month. The goal of the endometrial ablation is to actually remove that lining permanently so that women will either stop getting their period or their periods will be much lighter. And it's very effective. It's about 80 to 90% effective. About 30 to 40% of women won't get their periods, but 80 to 90% will be satisfied that it has significantly decreased their cramping and bleeding. This is going to be something that's recommended to only a certain women based on the size of the uterus and if there are any lesions inside, so it's not going to be a good fit for everybody. The other thing, even though I said it was permanent, the lining can grow back after several years, so if women are in their 30s and they have this done, they should expect that they may need to have it done again or need another procedure in a few years. However, if someone's in their mid to late 40s, this could very well carry them through to menopause. And so it does save a lot of women from hysterectomy. This type of surgery is something where you go home the same day, and really recovery is not very much more than just some cramping type pain. It is important to note that this is really reserved for women who are done childbearing, because we are burning away that lining, which is where a pregnancy would implant. So it is not birth control, so people can get pregnant after it, but it just wouldn't be a good idea because we're really taking away a vital part of the reproductive tract. So this is showing you a picture of a certain type of endometrial ablation called a thermochoice ablation. And this is a little balloon that's inserted into the uterine cavity, and this balloon is heated. And that heat serves to remove that endometrial lining. And so this is what it looks like afterward. And so you can see that the tissue actually looks charred here. Women will often have just kind of a watery, sometimes bloody discharge for a couple weeks after something like this. And it takes a couple of months before we can see what the final result will be, if it's going to stop their periods or cause their periods to be much later. A uterine artery embolization is a procedure that's actually done by interventional radiology, so not by a gynecologist. But it is an important thing to mention because it is a good option for women who have an enlarged fibroid uterus who want to avoid hysterectomy. So again, this is really reserved for women who have completed childbearing, because we're taking, by doing this procedure, what we do is we clot off the blood supply to the uterus. And so ideally women don't want to have children in the future. Again, this is really for women who have a uterus that's enlarged due to fibroids. So if you have other reasons for bleeding, this probably won't work for you. But when women have an enlarged fibroid uterus and we do this procedure, it actually can, it's one of the only procedures that can actually shrink the size of the uterus as well. And so this is showing you how it's done. So a radiologist will actually insert a catheter into one of the leg veins, and then we'll use imaging to guide that catheter all the way to the blood supply to the uterus and to the fibroids. And then once that catheter is in the right place, they'll inject a clotting substance that will clot off the blood supply to the uterus. The downside of this is that, occasionally this blood supply is shared with the ovaries. So there have been some reports of people going into early menopause after a procedure like this. Also, the way that this works and the way that it shrinks the fibroids is by cutting off the blood supply. And so what happens is that these will start to degenerate or die. When they're dying, people will sometimes feel some cramping pain, and very rarely that dead tissue can become infected. But that's a pretty rare complication. So for women who have fibroids that are causing them to have heavy bleeding, but they're not done having children, a myomectomy would be the procedure of choice. This is really the only surgical procedure that would spare a woman's fertility. A myomectomy can be done in a number of ways. So, as we talked about before, hysteroscopy can remove these fibroids here. If you do have some of these bigger fibroids on the outside or in the uterine wall, then you'd be looking at an abdominal surgery. And possibly a laparoscopy can be done, especially if there's one of these that are just on a little stalk. But oftentimes it will be a C-section type scar where they'll actually remove some of these fibroids one by one. And this type of procedure is actually sometimes done in order to improve fertility as well, because sometimes when women have all these fibroids, it can affect their ability to get pregnant. So finally, we are going to talk about hysterectomy. This is the most aggressive form of treatment, but it is considered the only definitive treatment. So I often get women who have been suffering from abnormal bleeding for years and years, and they just say, just take it out. And that's very reasonable, when women are done having kids and they've been trying all these other things. And luckily, we have ways of doing hysterectomy now that are minimally invasive and women recover quite nicely from. So before we start talking about hysterectomy, I just want to clarify some terms because it can be a little bit confusing. So when we talk about a total hysterectomy, what we're talking about is removal of the uterus and cervix. So a lot of times people think that that means we're going to take out the ovaries. But actually, we talk about the ovaries pretty separately. So when we say this, we mean the uterus and the cervix. However, we do know now that most ovarian cancer actually starts in the tubes. So whether or not you have your ovaries out, it is a good idea to have those fallopian tubes taken out to decrease the risk of ovarian cancer. So conversely, a subtotal or supracervical hysterectomy means that we're taking the uterus out, but we're leaving the cervix in place. And again, this can be with or without the ovaries. So why would we want to leave the cervix? So there are a couple of different reasons that people decide to leave the cervix. There was a lot of thought that the cervix provided pelvic support. So this actually does make a lot of good anatomic sense. The cervix is attached to other areas of the pelvis by these strong ligaments. And so the concern was if we take the cervix out, everything else is going to drop. The vagina is going to drop, the bladder is going to drop, all this stuff. So, however, they've done studies on whether or not it made a difference if you left the cervix or taken it, and it's really been pretty conflicting. So they haven't been able to really prove that it helps preserve pelvic support. Another reason that that we may decide to leave the cervix is if women have had a lot of prior surgery. Sometimes the cervix can be scarred to other organs. For example, when women have had a lot of C-sections or even one C-section, it can be scarred to the bladder. So sometimes taking out the cervix can be a little bit more risky because you have an increased risk of injuring the bladder by taking it out. Another thing is that there is some good blood supply to the cervix. So if a surgeon is worried about losing too much blood, then they may decide to leave the cervix behind. There are some very compelling reasons to take the cervix, however, the most obvious being a reduced risk of cervical cancer. So if a woman has had a history of abnormal pap smears, this is something that I really recommend pretty strongly. And if they haven't, then the good news is they don't need any more pap smears. So that's a nice benefit. We still recommend they come for a yearly exam, but they don't have to have that scraping of the vaginal tissue. Another good reason to take the cervix is that a lot of women are having their hysterectomy not only for bleeding but for pelvic pain. And the cervix can unfortunately be a continued source of pelvic pain. And so if that's something that's going on, again, I would recommend taking the cervix. And lastly, about 10% of the time when the cervix is left behind, women can have some continued cervical spotting with their menstrual periods. And this refers to if the ovaries are left in place. So even though the cervix doesn't have any endometrial tissue, when you leave the cervix behind, there's a chance that there can be some little bits of tissue attached. And so some women are unpleasantly surprised that they've had a hysterectomy and they still get a light spotting every month. Again, that's less than 10% of the time, but another reason that many women decide to just have the cervix removed as well. So if you decide to have a hysterectomy, another big decision is whether or not to have the ovaries removed at the same time. And this is something that's really going to be an individual decision, but the major things that go into this decision are a patient's individual risk factors. So when women are young or remote from menopause, we tend to leave them in unless they have a strong family history of ovarian or breast cancer. And the reason that we tend to leave them in is because once women go through menopause, we know that their risk for cardiovascular disease goes up. They start to lose bone mass. And they've actually done studies on women who have undergone hysterectomy and had their ovaries removed, and they've replicated this. So they've seen that those women that had their ovaries removed had an increased risk of death and an increased risk of cardiovascular disease. And so when you remove, the ovaries, you have to keep those things in mind. However, there are women who have, especially if you have a family history of breast or ovarian cancer, who removing the ovaries can be life-saving. And so, you really need to talk to your doctor about what your individual risks are and whether it makes sense for you. A general rule of thumb is that if you're pretty close to the average age of menopause, if you're 50 or 51, then probably removing them outweighs, the benefits of removing them outweighs the risks at that point. But you will undergo menopause if you haven't already once the ovaries are removed. So you may get some hot flashes and night sweats. Another reason that people remove the ovaries is people who have pelvic pain from endometriosis. There is some thought that if the ovaries are left, that people can continue to have pelvic pain or require additional surgery. So we're going to talk a little bit about the different types of hysterectomy. So abdominal hysterectomy is the classic hysterectomy that's done with an open incision. And the incision can either be a C-section type of incision or it can be a big up and down incision. And that would most likely depend on the size of the uterus. This is often necessary if the uterus is very big or if there's a concern for cancer, because if there is a significant concern for cancer, a lot of times the doctor wants the ability to remove lymph nodes. So that might be something that's planned in that case. The healing time from an abdominal hysterectomy is about 6 weeks. A vaginal hysterectomy is considered a minimally invasive hysterectomy because you don't get any abdominal incisions. It can be a really nice option, especially for women who have a small uterus and have a good-sized vaginal canal. And the reason that I mention the vaginal canal is because in this type of a surgery, the uterus has to be delivered through the vaginal canal. So people who haven't had babies, who maybe the vaginal canal is pretty narrow, this might not be a realistic option for those women. Because you're removing everything through the vagina, you do need to remove the cervix for this type of a hysterectomy. So laparoscopic hysterectomy, which is my personal favorite, is a minimally invasive type of hysterectomy. And the reason that I like this approach is because people recover really quickly from it. So you, instead of getting one big incision, you do get about three or four small incisions. Each incision is about an inch or less. And it allows you to visualize everything. You can see the uterus, you can see the ovaries, you can see if there's scar tissue. And so you can carefully dissect things before you remove them. Also, a lot of times when women are on the fence about removing their ovaries, we can kind of discuss, well, I'm going to take a good look at the ovaries, and if they're normal, I'm going to leave them. But if I see a big cyst or one of the ovaries looks abnormal, then I can remove just that one, and we can make a plan like that. So it has that, that option available. When you do a laparoscopic hysterectomy, you can also decide to take the cervix or leave it, and so it gives the patient more options in that regard as well. And people usually go home the next day from this type of surgery and are back to their normal activities within 2 weeks. So this is just showing you kind of when we're leaving the cervix behind, what this would entail, and this is when we take the cervix. This is what the instruments look like. There's a camera that goes through the belly button, and then there's usually two other little incisions that are made so that we can put our instruments through there. And this is what we see when we look inside. We see the uterus, we can see the ovaries and the fallopian tubes, and we can even take a look at other things. So we'll be able to see if there's adhesions where it's stuck to the bowel or stuck to the bladder, which is something you can't really see if you're doing a vaginal hysterectomy because you're doing that mostly by feel. So what type of hysterectomy is best? It really depends on a few different factors that we've mentioned a little bit already. The size of the uterus will come into play if there's suspicion for scar tissue. So a lot of times we can suspect that there's scar tissue. If someone's had C-sections or other abdominal surgeries, that would be something that would be more concerning for that. As we mentioned, the size of the vaginal canal and suspicion for cancer. So a lot of times women come in to discuss their bleeding with me because they're worried that their bleeding could mean something bad like cancer. And so when someone comes in with abnormal bleeding, there's a couple of things we want to do. We want to find out, do we need to do a biopsy? And we decide that based on their age and their risk factors. If someone is over 45, we almost always need to do a biopsy if there's been a significant change in their bleeding pattern. However, if they're under 45 and they have no risk factors, it might be something that's reasonable to just observe for a little while. However, if they persist or they don't respond to the typical therapy, then at that point you might want to consider doing a biopsy. Once we've ruled out cancer, or once we've decided that we don't need to rule out cancer at this point, we can really leave it up to the patient whether or not to do anything about this. So we want to make sure that a woman's not getting anemic from all the bleeding. We want to make sure that there's no risk of cancer or pre-cancer. But once those things are done, it really comes down to quality of life. And so if a woman comes in and says, well, yeah, I'm having this heavy bleeding, but it doesn't really bother me that much, then that's totally fine. But you know, I hope that going through all these things today, you've seen that when it does become an issue and becomes having a significant impact on someone's quality of life, that there are a lot of different treatment options, and they can really be individualized based on someone's preference. And that's it.
Thank you.
Any questions? Yes.
This may sound really silly, but if you have a hysterectomy out, well, what happens to the space? I mean, you just have a hole?
Well,
I don't know.
Yeah. So the question is, when you take out the uterus and the cervix, what happens to the space that it occupied? So when we take out the and you know, for the first example, we'll just talk about taking out the uterus. You know, when we're taking out the uterus, even if we take the cervix, you know, the other pelvic organs are left in place. So the ovaries have their, it's not shown in this picture, but they have their own blood supply that sort of comes off to the side here. And the bowel is in the back and surrounding all in the front. And in the front is the bladder. And really, you know, in reality, this is showing a big, you know, that the belly's been distended with air. But if we didn't distend this with air, everything would just be collapsing on top of each other. So while we do take this out and it creates a little bit of space, it's not as though there's a big gap there. In reality, all these things will just sort of fall back on each other once we take this out. But there is something to mention here. When we do take the cervix, this is the vagina right here. This is the vaginal canal. What we try to do is not shorten the vagina, and we have special techniques that allow us to keep the entire vaginal length so that it doesn't interfere with intercourse or anything like that. And then we take these two ends of the vagina and we sew them together so that you have a separation between your vagina and your abdominal contents. But it is important for recovery too, because we want to make sure that before people resume intercourse that this is nice and strong and that it's very well healed. So when people have this type of a hysterectomy, we see them back in the office usually in about 4 or 5 weeks. We do a good exam to make sure that that's really strong before we give them the green light to return to sexual activity. When we take just the uterus and leave the cervix, you know, looking at it vaginally, it'll look identical to someone that's not had their uterus removed. You'll see the cervix there on a pelvic exam, but if you were to feel to do an exam with your hands, you would just feel that the uterus was missing. Did that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay. Anybody else have any questions?
What's considered young for getting your period? Like, what's the range of years? Like you said, the length of, or somebody who got their period early.
So the question is, what's considered young for getting your period? And that's a tricky question because now we're seeing girls getting their periods just younger and younger and younger. But you know, I would say you below the age of 11, you know, would be considered young.
Do you see any vaginal fistulas, and what do you do to correct that?
So the question is, do we see any vaginal fistulas? So a vaginal fistula is when there's a hole or a connection between vaginal tissue and something else. So it can be anywhere. It can be between the bladder or between the vagina and the bowel. I don't really see a lot of them. It's certainly a complication, but it's pretty rare. So we don't really see very many fistulas at all. But hysterectomy in general is a risk factor for fistula. And in our country, that it is one of the most common reasons we see fistulas. In other developing nations, they see fistulas more from obstructed childbirth. But I don't see them very frequently, no. But if you were gonna correct them, what they normally do is they have to do a special type of study to identify where the hole is and then remove the hole between, if it's the vagina and the bowel, they'll kind of incise that hole and sew those two organs up separately so that they have healthy tissue that they're bringing together, because the tissue where the hole is often just not very viable.
Can that be done relatively quickly?
Well, it can, but it's done by a specialist. It's usually done by a urogynecologist or a colorectal surgeon, depending on where the fistula is. Any other questions? Yeah.
Could you discuss endometriosis in abnormal bleeding?
Sure. So the question was, can we discuss endometriosis in abnormal uterine bleeding? So endometriosis, see if I have a good. So endometriosis is a condition where the lining of the uterus here makes its way outside of the uterus and implants in other places within the abdominal cavity or sometimes even farther away. But what happens is, because this is the tissue, remember, that you shed every month when you have your period, is that people usually get cyclical pain. And this can actually progress to the point where when this tissue has been there for a while, people can develop little scar tissue or adhesions, and the pain can go from being just with their periods to all of a sudden they have pain all the time. And so endometriosis is an interesting disorder because sometimes people have a lot of pelvic pain from it, and we go do a surgery and we find very little on surgery, and other times we find it just out of coincidence when we're doing a tubal ligation and the patient's completely not bothered by it, but they have little implants everywhere. So in terms of how it affects bleeding, it doesn't really affect bleeding at all. So when someone has endometriosis and they're having irregular bleeding, then I start to suspect that there might be something else going on as well. And so people can a lot of times have multiple things going on that can be affecting their bleeding and pain. Anybody else? Dr. Lee.
I was going to ask you, but did you come across, or have you come across the role of bleeding in the cervix for sexual? Because I came across that once.
I almost put it in there, but I didn't. I didn't put it in there because I didn't even want to have the power of. Oh, okay, I'm sorry. So the question was, what about the role of the cervix for sexual function? And I was starting to say, I thought about putting that in this slide because patients do bring that up, and it is something that sometimes people will find on the internet and things like that. But there's really been no studies showing that that's true. And so, but once it's mentioned, it's sort of hard to get that idea out of your head. And obviously no one wants to undergo a hysterectomy and have their sexual function impaired. So it is something that's been suggested, but they've done studies on it and it's not really been shown. Anybody else?
I just have a question. Why are you finding that young girls are getting their period earlier and earlier? What is the reason for that? Is there any justification?
Well, I don't really have an expert opinion on this, but I'll just tell you kind of what I'm, you know, familiar with as some of the current theories, which are not really proven. I think people are looking into this, but some of it has to do with the food that we're ingesting and some of the hormones that we're exposed to in our diet. And so that's why some of the countries have decided that they're not going to allow some of these hormones in milk and things like that, because there is a thought on that, but it's not been, you know, very strongly proven, but that's one of the leading thoughts. Anybody else? Well, thank you so much for joining me, and I hope that we didn't go too fast.